Hello guys, as a part of VTU eShikshana program, the session number 7 with respect to computer networks and security subject, where I am dealing with application layer. Okay, just a takeaway from the previous session, I was discussing about various protocols that concern to email operation, like SMTP protocol, POP3 protocol, IMAP protocol, and so on. In this lecture, I am going to deliver a very important topic of application layer called as domain name server or domain names, how the domain names can be operated. Okay, so first of all, let me introduce what is domain name server and how it works and what are the operations and how the domain names can be considered and how the conflict can be resolved in this lecture. The domain names are nothing but the global database system for internet addressing, mailing, and other information. And we may have a confusion that why we have, for example, if you would have taken your own website like vtu.ac.in, and if you would have taken some other Flipkart website or it might be Amazon website, the name of the website will be name of the company itself, amazon.com, flipkart.com, correct? So why? What is the reason? The very simple reason is that which makes the user to remember the websites very easily. Okay, so actually in the, at the back end, all these domain names are assigned with one or the other IP addresses. It's very hard to remember the numbers, correct? No, so if you would have taken an example of your the mobile devices wherein which we have the contact numbers, instead of remembering the contact numbers, we used to remember the name of the person, correct? No, so which makes life simple and also our memory will work finely with the names rather than the numbers. Correct? So instead of remembering the numbers, what we used to remember, always the name of the person. Correct? So here also for the corresponding contact names, there will be the numbers. Similarly, here also for the corresponding domain names, there will be assigned, but by importantly, we have an IP addresses for each and every domain. Just to make easier to use and memorize, we have the domain names. We'll study the detailed aspects of domain names, subdomains, and other details. And mainly, I think in the beginning of your application layer module, I have given importance towards URL, Uniform Resource Locator. We have host name followed by the query string and other things. Initially, we have the HTTP protocol and other details. Similarly, for each and every domains, we have domain names. There will be a concept of subdomains also. Okay, domains and subdomains. For example, I have a domain called vtu.ac.in. Within that, I want to open one more important web page. I can call that sub page as subdomain of vtu.ac.in. Okay, so this is one important thing. And why we require domain name server? Domain name server's job, important goal, is to translate domain names to IP addresses. You have to remember this always. The main job of domain names is to convert all your domain names to IP addresses. Okay, to fetch the data, for example, if you type in the google.com, okay, once you press enter, the domain name server immediately convert the domain names to the corresponding IP address, and that IP address will send a request to the actual server. Okay, so the help of domain names which will not send any kind of request or which will not do any operation, just for the user interface and just for memorizing and used to easy to use, we have the domain names. Okay. I hope so you got the basic introduction towards the domain names. Let me move further. Okay, some of the top level domains. Okay, I think you might have been heard of all these domain names: .com, .org, .net, .gov. .com is mainly meant for commercialized websites, .org for non-profitable websites, and .net for the network service providers, and .gov for US government, and ML for military, EDU for education. Similarly, we have other top level domains. Okay, these are not only the domain names, we have other domain names also. These are the top level domains, I mean commonly used across globe. Okay, if you have taken the example of Flipkart, flipkart.com, correct? The meaning of that is it's a commercial one. So, how the domain name structure will be, you know, it will be organized. Okay, let us consider an example as an example randomly as vvc.ac.in. Okay, and one more example as mce.ac.in. A random example, two college websites I've taken. Okay, so it's always end with .in. This represents it's an Indian website. So we have a .in here. Okay, within that we have commonly as within that we have many subdomains, correct? No, AC, academic institution, NIC, we have EDU, we have a lot of things, lot of other examples. So within that I have to go with the structure of AC. You can see here we have to go within the AC. I don't want to go within NIC. Okay, so within that AC I want to go within Vidyavardhaka College of Engineering, I mean to say VVC, or I want to go with Malnad College of Engineering, MCE. Within that, which department you have to visit, and it so goes on, which faculty and whatever the details you want to fetch the data. At the end of the day, what I want to concern, give the representation of domain name structure is, it is a tree-like structure. It is a hierarchical tree-like structure, follows with the root node, and this node is called as root. Part of the domain names we can call it as root node. Okay, and these are called as host names and these are called as domains. Okay, so within that, which is the actual subdomain we have to check with, that we have to retract, or we can also call it as tracing. Okay, so this is the domain name structure of any domain names we have with. Okay, so the server also, whatever the domain names you had given, that domain names will be constructed in this particular fashion itself. Okay, so this is an example, and just a statistical information, the number of, I think it's very old information, just for your understanding, in 1991 the .com usage was just 200, think of it. Okay, and .net and .org usage was just 55. Okay, and in 1995, just in the span of 5 years, it's increased to 4 digits, and in this increased to 3 digits. Okay, so think of about 2020 or 2015 or something like that. That it's a very huge demand of usage of all these things as the complete global is turning towards digitization. Okay, this is very important information you have to remember, how the domain names has been diversely used across globe. Okay, and many times you may have a confusion, is that possible to have two domain names for two same domains or same host names and all? For example, vvc.ac.in, same thing I can assign with some other thing? No, we cannot able to keep. Understood? Okay, so the commonly used server is by name called as Berkeley Intel domain name, runs at a Unix process called name, and when an application needs some information from the server, it invokes a DNS name resolver, okay, to check whether the name domain names have already used or it is using for the first time. The completely it will check out, and DNS translates fully qualified domain name into corresponding IP address using the command NS lookup table. Okay, I think you might have been used this command at all. Remember, within which we can able to, if you type in case of a command prompt, NS lookup space, some domain names like vvc.ac.in or whatever it might be, immediately it will give the IP address of it. Okay, so might have been, this is the usage of lookup. Okay, the lookup completely stores all the domain names corresponding IP addresses. For example, it's a database consisting of two columns, wherein which one is domain names followed by IP address. For example, I have vtu.ac.in that corresponds to present in the NS lookup table. So what we have a command called NS lookup space, the domain names if you are given, it will correspondingly give the corresponding IP address of that particular domain names. Okay, so this is what exactly fully qualified domain name is nothing but completely domain name. That is the complete detailing of domain name. If you have given, we can call them as fully qualified domain names. If you have not given a complete domain name, just if you have given VTU, I don't know, I have not given AC.in, just VTU. This is not fully qualified domain names. If it is VTU.AC.in, this is the fully qualified domain names. Okay, so if the name server does not have the information locally, it asks its primary server and so on. Okay, so whenever you want to fetch the data, for example, this is a root node. This is a root node I have, and it wants to fetch the information of Stanford University, stanford.edu. Okay, so what it does, it will not always fetch the data from the root node. It will ask for the local server. It will ask for the local server, and if that is present in that local server itself, that will be sent back to the user. Okay, for redundancy, each host may also have one or more secondary name servers which may be queried with the primary when the primary fails. Whenever the primary node fails to work, it will ask the secondary servers to fetch the data and to check whether the names are present or not, and to check whether the redundancy has been happened or not. Okay, by redundancy, by duplicating the data, that will create the conflicts, and that can resolve with the help of domain name servers. Okay, it might be not only with edu, it might be of .com, it might be of .in, whatever it might be, it does not want to fetch the data from the primary main root server always. It can fetch the data from the local servers also. Whenever the primary server fails to work, then only it can able to fetch the data from the secondary servers. That's all. I think we are keep on talking about this recursive name resolution. Whenever the client wants to fetch the data of stanford.edu and he wants to fetch the data from yahoo.com, and many times there is a situation within which we can have stanford.in. Stanford by keeping the name, but the domain name is different. That is possible. Okay, sometimes that may not be given acceptance by particular domain names also, host names also. Okay, so whenever I want to fetch the data, it perform the operation in this recursive name resolution. What the client will does, he will type this stanford.edu, and what is the part here, Stanford, it will go here, and it will check whether this stanford.edu is present or not, and then it will check with the route, and it will get the data. Okay, and sometimes using this stanford.edu, client wants to fetch the data of yahoo.com, for example. Okay, if it is present in the local server itself, if it is present in the local server, it will take the data from the local server. If it is not present, he will send the data to edu, and edu is not at all matching with .com, so he will contact the root node, and he will check where the .com presents, and it will go there, and it will check for yahoo, and it will fetch the data, and it will send back the data to the client. I hope you got the logic of this. Whenever the client want to fetch the data of domain names, it has to fetch the data from the root node if the locally if it is not present. Okay, for example, client want to check stanford.edu or want to connect. What it does, client will give the domain name as stanford.edu, and it will check with this edu, and it will check with the root, and it will give the response for the client. Okay, at the same time, client want to fetch the data of yahoo.com with the help of stanford.edu because it's already connected. So what the client does, he will type yahoo.com. Whenever he typed yahoo.com, it will check with the nearest thing. As it is not mapping with edu, it will go for the root. If the .com is nearly present somewhere here, locally, it will fetch the data from there itself. If it is not present, with the help of edu, it will match. No, it does not match. It will go for the root, and it will check for the .com, and it will fetch the data of Yahoo, and it will send back the data to the client. Okay, this is called as recursive name resolution. Okay, this is called as recursive name resolution. And there is a situation where a DNS caching. Caching, I think we all know that it's a temporary memory. And once name server learns mapping, it catches mapping. and cache enters timeout using TTL called as time to leave. It will, the cache data will not stored always permanently. There is a mechanism called as time to leave. Based on the time to leave mechanism, it will be assigned with some time slices. Whenever the time completes, time elapses, the data will be automatically deleted from the cache memory. Okay, so such records are called as DNS records. Okay, so DNS distributed DB storing resource records, such records are called as resource records. And what is the format of resource records? The format of resource records having a quadruple followed by the name, value, type and TTL. TTL is a time slice, for example, seconds or 30 seconds or 1 minute, whatever, 60 minutes, 60 seconds, whatever. That will be given with the help of TTL, called as time to leave, very important parameter that this resource records present in the cache. What is the time elapses, time this resource record present in the cache memory. Okay, what is the name? Name is the host name. What is the value? Value is the IP address. What are type? What type of domain name it's going to use. Okay, for example, if you have taken example of v2.ac.in, v2 is the host name followed by the IP address of that, followed by the .ac.in, that is .in, followed by the time slices. Okay, this complete information will be present in the DNS cache with the help of resource records. Okay, I think I have given the brief introduction towards the DNS, what is DNS, followed by DNS mechanism, how DNS mechanism works, followed with the help of how name resolution works, how DNS caching works, what is DNS records, and so on. Okay, now we'll see how DNS protocol message formats looks like. DNS protocol has query and reply messages, obviously, correct? No, both with the same message format. Okay, so what are the message format consists of? Why this message format consists of two important things? One is query and reply, because DNS, with the help of DNS, it has to send a request, and with the help of the server, it has to get back the reply. So we have query and reply message format. Okay, which consists of 12 bytes of identification, flags, number of questions, number of answers with respect to resource records, number of authority with respect to resource records, and number of additional resource records. The complete details of flags identification, I think identification is a unique one to avoid redundancy, or how many requests it has been sent, number of questions, resource records, and the name type field for a query is present in the next field called questions, variable number of questions. Okay, and similarly, resource record in response to query, we have the answers field, variable number of resource record, followed by the authority field, followed by the additional information field. Corresponding to these four fields, we have the questions, answers, and authority, and additional records. Okay, this is the protocol message format of the DNS with respect to query and reply messages. Okay, and along with this DNS, many times we have asked, the complete globe has been utilized with DNS, domain names and all. We have huge number of network security attacks also happens. One such attack is called as distributed denial of service attack. Before knowing the knowledge of distributed denial of service attack, we have to know what is the meaning of denial of service attack. Okay, there is a mechanism or a process in which making the actual user to get the denial of that particular service. For example, I want to use flipkart.com. The attacker which hinders the usage of my request. For example, even though I send a request, I will not get the response for larger amount of time. Okay, this making the delay for the respective authenticated user, we can call it as denial of service attack. How it does, there is an attacker. Okay, the mechanism follows like this. Okay, there is an attacker, and I am an actual user. I want to fetch the data from this flipkart.com. There's an attacker, he keep on sending the request by hindering this particular request. What is the server will does? The server will think that, okay, I'm getting the actual request from here, so this is the No, not the actual request. So this is an attacker node actually. Even though it is a validated node, this will not get the response. This deny is called as deny loss of this attack by sending the flood of request to the server. Okay. Similarly, we have one more attack called a distributed denial of service attack, wherein which in this case we have a single pawn, single node. We have in the distributed denial of service attack, we have the nodes across the globe send the request to server, which hinders the user request. Okay, not successful or to data traffic filtering, local DNS no servers cache IP to TLD servers, allowing root servers bypasses and potentially more dangerous to the actual users. Okay, so these are the different things with respect to denial of service attack. There are two more attacks called as redirect attacks. The one such attack is called as man in the middle attack. As the name itself indicates, the person who lies between the client and server. I am the actual client actually. For example, the attacker lies here and this is the actual server. What the man in the middle attack will does, whatever the request he'll got, he will keep a copy of this request and he will send the duplicate of it. What the server will think that, oh, I got a request from the actual client, but he got a request from the attacker. Okay, so he will reply back formally. And this attacker keep the reply and he will send the duplicate. We don't know whether he modified the reply or not. This attacker, which lies between the client and server, acting like a client for the server and server for the client, and we can call it as a man in the middle attack. Okay, and DNS poisoning, sending the establishing the duplicate DNS servers, sending bogus replies to DNS server, and these are called as DNS poisoning. And exploit DNS and DDoS. Okay, send queries with spoofed source IP address. By making the target, and that target IP address will get nullified, and these are the major attacks we can have in the DNS DNS mechanism. Okay, so I think we discussed the what is DNS, the mechanism of DNS, how DNS works, how DNS name resolution can be works, top level domains and name resolution. And we went with the structure of the DNS message format, followed by the DNS cache, and also by the attacking. Okay, so this is all about DNS, domain name server. Usually in your examination you may get a question like, what is DNS, explain how name resolution can be resolved, or what are the attacks of DNS. Okay, so if you have any questions, you can contact me with my email ID. Thank you so much for your patience listening. Thank you so much.